Hello, everyone. I'm Kimberly Gray, and I thank you very much for being here tonight. We're really grateful for your presence at this tribute to Evan Boland, a dear teacher, colleague, beloved poet, and friend to many of us across the world. I would like to extend my sincerest love and condolences to everyone, most especially to Evan's family, her husband, Kevin, her daughters, Evan and Sarah, and her grandchildren. I would also like to say thank you to Natalie Jabbar, who is hosting us tonight, and to Richie Hoffman and Mark Wunderlich for being wonderful collaborators. In A Journey with Two Maps, Evan wrote, "There is nothing settled about a poet's identity. The becoming doesn't stop because the being has been achieved. They proceed together." Evan was not only a celebrative and subversive Irish poet and champion of women writers, she has also been integral to the landscape of American poetry through the curation of the best creative writing program in the world at Stanford University. Tonight, Stegner Fellows from the past 28 years will read Evan's work, honoring the immense influence of both her poetry and her direction of the Wallace Stegner Program, a program that grants writers the gift of time, community, and mentorship as they proceed on becoming and being writers in the world. First, we will hear from three of Evan's closest colleagues and friends, beginning with writer Tobias Wolff. Thank you, Toby, for starting us off.
Well, Kimberly, thank you and Natalie for bringing us all together in this tribute to Evan. I'm sure that you all feel what I feel, the kind of aching emptiness in our thought of that office where we all went in and came out usually laughing. I will hold Evan in my heart for the rest of my life. She was one of the best friends I ever had. And she was a good friend to all of you. I'm going to read her poem, Quarantine. It's a well-known poem, you all know it. One of the things that is so striking to me about this poem is that elemental sense of family and the kind of mutual generosity that runs between people in that basic relationship. And you see it again and again in her poetry. I think of that beautiful poem of hers, Love, in which she and her husband are crossing a bridge over the river in Iowa City, having nearly lost one of their daughters. And that sense of an almost mythic bond as they stand on that bridge could have been evoked by Dante. And that sense of that bond that exists in a family is something that she had a gift for extending beyond her immediate family. All of us felt it, were embraced by it. I'm going to read Quarantine. In the worst hour of the worst season, of the worst year of a whole people, a man set out from the workhouse with his wife. He was walking. They were both walking north. She was sick with famine fever and could not keep up. He lifted her and put her on his back. He walked like that west and west and north until at nightfall under freezing stars they arrived. In the morning they were both found dead of cold, of hunger, of the toxins of a whole history. But her feet were held against his breastbone. The last heat of his flesh was his last gift to her. Let no love poem ever come to this threshold. There is no place here for the inexact praise of the easy graces and sensuality of the body. There is only time for this merciless inventory. Their death together in the winter of 1847. Also, what they suffered, how they lived, and what there is between a man and a woman, and in which darkness it can best be proved. Our next speaker is Ken Fields.
Hi, thanks, Toby. I'm just going to be brief. Two things going on as I'm looking at this. One, I'm uplifted by all the people who loved Ivan. And also, I'm saddened by what it means that she really is gone. And we won't be able to hear her say hiya or how are ya if you walk down those halls. I'm going to ask you forgiveness because a few of you have heard this, others have not. I'm simply going to read you a poem in three short sections that I did 3 days after Ivan died. And then I'll tell you a brief little story about Bacon. This is called The First 3 Days Without Ivan. Chioscuro. Emptiness is in the air. You are on your way away from us. The morning has turned dark, shadow that gives light more than depth, dark green still glimmering. A friend writes, she didn't make it. I think you did. Everything I would have said to you, I will say always. The photograph, to be seen even by your photograph, is to be pierced straight to the heart. The ferocity of your love and its tenderness follow me. Ah, the power of absence here, or alas, apart. The hand. Stars wheel still above my dark cave. I hear the little stream outside, inside and out coalesce in the ear. I see a clear light before me, 2 or 3 feet away. It is, and it is the size of a child's closed hand, printed on the wall. It opens worlds, worlds in my small darkness. Now for Bacon. Before Ivan got here, John LaRoe, the director of the program then, and his wife Joan and Nora and I would meet for breakfast 5 mornings a week over at Tresidder. And when Ivan got here, she joined us right away, became what one of Joan called a Chatham member. I think she was warned by one of our colleagues in English that this meeting with us might influence her, badly. Which is hilarious to me. And maybe it did, I don't know. But I always had the same thing, bacon toast and scrambled eggs. And if you're bacon lovers, you know that you eat the bacon with the eggs and toast, but you save that last piece of bacon, you know, to really enjoy at the end. And Ivan would always look over at my plate and she would say, I'm going to take, do you mind if I take one of your pieces of bacon? And she would eat it. She's the only person in the world I would let eat my last piece of bacon. That's how much I loved her. Maybe Nora could do it, but she wouldn't ask. And I just keep trying to remember as I go through my day, thinking over many times, that loss is forever, but so is love. Christina.
It's wonderful to see so many of you here tonight. I was really fortunate to work very closely with the VAN for the past 10 years as an administrator in the creative writing program. And it was wonderful working with her. She made my job so easy and fun. I'll miss her so much. She did a lot for me personally and professionally. But tonight I want to talk about one of the things she did. One of her roles was to be a very fierce advocate for writers and for the writing life. And this is what I helped her with. She was really committed, as someone mentioned the other night, to making sure that all undergraduates could take creative writing, which is unusual. At most schools, it's difficult to get into creative writing classes. So she worked hard to get funding for more lecturers and more classes. And she was open to all styles and genres. So over the years, as the students told us how important Harry Potter was to them and The Hunger Games and these kinds of books, she was firm that we should offer young adult writing because that's where their interest was. If the students were interested in multimedia, then we're going to offer the graphic novel project so they can explore that. And we're going to support a poetry into film contest and the Spoken Word Collective, and so many things like that. She supported the writing life of the undergrads. And then, of course, one of her primary missions was to support the lecturers. And she protected their writing time by getting their teaching load reduced so that they would have more time to write. And she insisted and worked for fair compensation for everything the lecturers do. You know, there were many things that the university was asking lecturers to do that they didn't get paid for. So she worked to get lecturers paid for mentoring students in honors in the arts, increasing the pay for independent studies and things like this. And I think this was all to support the writing life so that our lecturers wouldn't have to get extra jobs, or at least not as much as before. And then she really recognized the contribution of the lecturers, how they had helped our program to grow and become so popular. And she was always telling everybody in meetings how wonderful, what wonderful teachers and mentors all of you are. And then Stegner Fellows, all of you, she worked hard to always constantly improve the program. And, you know, by adding health insurance and significantly increasing the stipend. So I helped her in this role of sort of the institutional support, the material support. And the goal was really to support all of you in creating your art. So I feel really lucky that I was able to help her in this important work. And I really pledge to try to continue that legacy that she created. Thank you.
Thank you so much for everything you do, Christina. Thank you. We'll now turn to current and former Stegner Fellows. Each of us here has been touched and had our lives changed by Ivan's teaching and artistry and leadership. Each reader will introduce themselves and share a favorite poem by Ivan. We'll begin with Tracy K. Smith.
Thank you. I guess I just want to start out by saying what a gift and an honor it was to study with Ivan. I feel like I was a child when I was at Stanford, and her presence in the classroom and her perspective on the endeavor that we were setting out to undertake helped me clarify for myself why poetry was important to me. I feel like that space also helped me decide what I would give up for writing, what I would be willing to admit to myself in order to write better poems. And that was hard, but it was also something that I think she took a great deal of care in guiding each of us toward in our own way. I'm gonna read her poem, It's a Woman's World. Our way of life has hardly changed since a wheel first whetted a knife. Maybe flame burns more greedily and wheels are steadier, but we're the same. We milestone our lives with oversights, living by the lights of the loaf left by the cash register, the washing powder paid for and wrapped, the wash left wet. Like most historic peoples, we are defined by what we forget and what we never will be. Stargazers, fire eaters. It's our alibi for all time. As far as history goes, we were never on the scene of the crime. When the king's head gored its basket, grim harvest, we were gristing bread or getting the recipe for a good soup. It's still the same. Our windows moth our children to the flame of hearth, not history. And still, no page scores the low music of our outrage. Appearances reassure. That woman there, craned to the starry mystery, is merely getting a breath of evening air. While this one here, her mouth a burning plume, she's no fire eater, just my frosty neighbor coming home. Thank you. The next reader is Kevin Young.
Hi, everyone. Sorry, I had a technical problem, but I think I'm back. It's good to see everyone, even for this occasion. I actually wasn't a student of Evan's. She came after I left 26 years ago. And I got to know her, though, personally, as she invited me back over the past number of years, including last year to give the Lane Lecture around this very time. To me, she was always generous and fierce. In late February this year, I took two poems of her, from her for The New Yorker. And as I told her then, I would have gladly have taken all she sent. We ran one of them, Eviction, on what turned out to be the day she died. We ran the other, The Fire Gilder, the week after, along with what must have been one of the last recordings she'll ever make. I'll read that poem tonight. The Fire Gilder. She loved silver. She loved gold, my mother. She spoke about the influence of metals, the congruence of atoms, the art classes where she learned these things. Think of it, she would say, as she told me to gild any surface a master craftsman had to meld gold with mercury, had to heat both so one was volatile, one was not, and to do it right had to separate them and then burn, 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 burn mercury until it fled and left behind a skin of light. The only thing, she added, but what came after that, I forgot. What she spent a lifetime forgetting could be my subject. The fenced-in small towns of Leinster, the coastal villages where the language of the sea was handed on, phrases bruised by storms, by shipwrecks, but isn't. My subject is the part wishing plays in the ways villages are made to vanish, in the way I learned to separate memory from knowledge. So one was volatile, one was not. and how I started writing, burning light, building heat, until all at once I was the fire gilder, ready to lay radiance down, ready to decorate. It happened with it never did. When all at once, I remember what it was, she said, the only thing is, it is extremely dangerous. And the next reader is Mark Wunderlich.
Thank you, Kevin. One of the things that I really admired so much about Ivan and will always be grateful for was just seeing how hard she worked to make a place for young poets, for idiosyncrasy, for creativity within an institution like Stanford University, which is about an institution that concentrates wealth and power to tremendous degrees. And within that, she found a way to get resources to young poets of America. And that was a tremendous skill and a real gift. I'm going to read her poem called Home, which was dedicated to Jody Allen Randolph. Off a side road in Southern California is a grove of eucalyptus. It looks as if someone once came here with a handful of shadows, not seeds, and planted them. And they turned into trees. But the leaves have a telltale blueness and deepness. Up a slope to the left is a creek. Across it lies a cut down tree trunk. Further back again is the faraway filtered out glitter of the Pacific. I went there one morning with a friend in mid-October, when the monarch butterflies arrive from their westward migration. Thousands of them, hundreds of thousands collecting in a single location. I climbed to the creek and looked up. Every leaf was covered and ended in a fluttering struggle. Atmosphere, ocean, oxygen, and dust were altered by their purposes. They had changed the trees to iron. They were rust. I looked at my watch. It was early, but my mind was ready for the evening they were darkening into overhead. Every inch and atom of daylight was filled with their beating and flitting, their rising and flying at the hour when dusk falls on a coastal city, where I had my hands full of shadows once and planted them. And they became a suburb and a house and a doorway entered by and open to an evening. Every room was lighted to offset. I once thought that a single word had the power to change, to transform, but these had not been changed, and I would not be changed by it again. If I could not say the word home, if I could not breathe the Irish night air and interference of rain coming from the east, I could at least be sure, far below them, and unmoved by movement, of one house with its window making an oblong of wheat out of light. And our next reader is Monica Suk.
Hi, everyone. I'm so grateful that I had the opportunity to learn with Ivan, and she has no doubt changed my life as a poet. I'm so grateful. I'm going to read The Lost Land. I have two daughters. They are all I ever wanted from the earth, or almost all. I also wanted one piece of ground, one city trapped by hills, one urban river, an island in its element, so I could say mine, my own, and mean it. Now they are grown up and far away, and memory itself has become an immigrant, wandering in a place where love dissembles itself as landscape, where the hills are the colors of a child's eyes, where my children are distances, horizons. At night, on the edge of sleep, I can see the shore of Dublin Bay, its rocky sweep and its granite pier. Is this, I say, how they must have seen it, backing out on the mailboat at twilight, shadows falling on everything they had to leave and would love forever? And then I imagine myself at the landward rail of that boat, searching for the last sight of a hand. I see myself on the underworld side of that water, the darkness coming in fast, saying all the names I know for a lost land, Ireland, absence, daughter. And the next reader is Gabby Cavalcaresi.
Hi, everyone. Yvan's book, it was the first book by a woman poet that I ever bought. I was in high school. And then somehow I ended up being at Stanford with her and being given the great gifts of her presence, her kindness, her care. Yvan Boland gave me a significant amount of my life then and now, and in ways I'm sure I'll never even know. And I am grateful and I love her very much. I'm going to read The Pomegranate. The only legend I have ever loved is the story of a daughter lost in hell and found and rescued there. Love and blackmail are the gist of it. Ceres and Persephone, the names. And the best thing about the legend is I can enter it anywhere, and have. As a child in exile, in a city of fogs and strange consonants, I read it first, and at first I was an exiled child in the crackling dusk of the underworld, the stars blighted. Later, I walked out in a summer twilight, searching for my daughter at bedtime. When she came running, I was ready to make any bargain to keep her. I carried her back past white beams and wasps and honey-scented buddleias. But I was Ceres then, and I knew winter was in store for every leaf on every tree on that road, was inescapable for each one we passed, and for me. It is winter, and the stars are hidden. I climb the stairs and stand where I can see my child asleep beside her teen magazines, her can of Coke, her plate of uncut fruit, the pomegranate. How did I forget it? She could have come home and been safe and ended the story and all our heartbroken searching, but she reached out a hand and plucked a pomegranate. She put out her hand and pulled down the French sound for apple and the noise of stone and the proof that even in the place of death, at the heart of legend, in the midst of rocks full of unshed tears, ready to be diamonds by the time the story was told, a child can be hungry. I could warn her. There is still a chance. The rain is cold. The road is flint colored. The suburb has cars and cable television. The veiled stars are above ground. It is another world. But what else can a mother give her daughter but such beautiful rifts in time? If I defer the grief, I will diminish the gift. The legend will be hers as well as mine. She will enter it as I have. She will wake up. She will hold the papery flushed skin in her hand, into her lips. I will say nothing. Our next reader is John Evans.
This is Moths. Tonight the air smells of cut grass. Apples rust on the branches. Already summer is a place mislaid between expectation and memory. This has been a summer of moths. Their moment of truth comes well after dark. Then they reveal themselves at our window, ledges and sills as a pinpoint. The glimmer. The books I look up about them are full of legends. Ghost swift moths with their dancing assemblies at dusk, their courtship swarms, how some kinds may steer by the moon. The moon is up. The back windows are wide open. Mid-July light fills the neighborhood. I stand by the hedge. Once again, they are near the windowsill, fluttering past the fuchsia and the lavender, which is knee-high and too blue, to warn them they will fall down without knowing how or why what they steered by became suddenly what they crackled and burned around. They will perish. I am perishing. On the edge and at the threshold of the moment all nature fears and tends towards. The stealing of the light. Ingenious facsimile. In the kitchen bulb which beckons them, makes my child's shadow longer than my own. The next reader is Nan Cohen.
First one to forget to unmute. Ivan wrote Tree of Life shortly before she came to Stanford, when she was poet in residence at the National Maternity Hospital in Dublin. And if you ever heard her read this poem, you know that she'd say that when her own daughters were born in that hospital, the last person she would have liked to have seen coming through the door was the poet in residence. But she was always aware that her own grandmother had died there as well, and that it was a place for endings as well as beginnings. And this is how she came to lead a group for people whose babies had died. And for service, this poem, which, as she said, really honor the determination of people to find an image to express that experience. To me, it stands at the intersection of her gifts as a poet and a human being. Tree of Life. A tree on a moonless night has no sap or color. It has no flower and no fruit. It waits for the sun to find them. I cannot find you in this dark hour, dear child. Wait for dawn to make us clear to one another. Let the sun inch above the rooftops. Let love be the light that shows again, the blossom to the root. The next reader is Richie Hoffman.
To memory. This is for you, goddess that you are. This is a record for us both. This is a chronicle. There should be more of them. They should be lyrical and factual and true. They should be written down and spoken out on rainy afternoons, instead of which they fall away. So I have written this, so it will not. My last childless winter was the same as all the other ones. Outside my window, the motherless landscape hoarded its own kind. Light fattened the shadows. Frost harried the snowdrops. There was a logic to it, the way my mother loved astrology. She came from a valley in the country where everything that was haphazard and ill-timed about our history had happened. And so it seemed natural that what she wanted most were the arts of the predetermined. My child was born at the end of winter. How to prove it? Not the child, of course, who slept in pre-spring darkness, but the fact that the ocean, moonless, stripped of current, entered the room quietly one evening and lay down in the weave of the rug and could be seen shifting and sighing in blue-green sisal. And I said nothing about it, then or later, to anyone. And when the spring arrived, I was ready to see a single field in the distance on the Dublin hills allow its heathery color to detach itself and come upstairs and settle in the corner of the room furthest from the window. I could, of course, continue. I could list for you a whole inventory of elements and fixed entities that broke away and found themselves disordered in that season, its unruly happenstance, without a thought for laws that until then had barred an apple flower from opening at midnight, or lilac rooting in the coldest part of the ocean. Then it stopped. Little by little, what was there came back. Slowly at first, then surely. I realized what had happened was secret, hardly possible, to be remembered always, which is why you are listening as rain comes down, restored to its logic, responsive to air and land. And I am telling you this. You are, after all, not simply the goddess of memory. You have 9 daughters yourself and can understand. The next reader is Sarah Micus Martin.
And soul. My mother died one summer, the wettest in the record of the state. Crops rotted in the west, checked tablecloths dissolved in back gardens, empty deck chairs collected rain. As I took my way to her through traffic, through lilacs dripping blackly, behind houses and on curbsides, to pay her the last tribute of a daughter, I thought of something. I remembered I heard once that the body is, or is said to be, almost all water. And as I turned southward, that ours is a city of it, one in which every single day the elements begin a journey toward each other that will never, given our weather, fail. The ocean visible in the edges cut by it, cloud color reaching into air, the Liffey storing one and summoning the other, salt greeting the lack of it at the north wall, and as if that wasn't enough, all of it, ending up almost every evening inside our speech. Coast, canal, ocean, river, stream, and now, mother. And I drove on, and although the mind is unreliable in grief, at the next cloudburst, it almost seemed they could be shades of each other, the way the body is of every one of them. And now they were on the move again, fog into mist, mist into sea spray, and both into the oily glaze that lay on the railings of the house she was dying in as I went inside. Kai Carson Wee.
Well, it's such an honor to be reading with you all today in our grief and in our remembering of Evan. I know we're keeping the intros brief, but I just wanted to say one thing. Evan to me was so many different roles in my life. She was my professor, my mentor, my confidant in the, you know, gossip of the poetry world. She was my friend, and she was a big believer in my work. And I come from a family of Lutheran pastors, and I grew up around people of faith, and I learned to recognize that quality. And Evan had such a deep and abiding faith in poetry and in her students and in their work as writers in the world. And we're all just so lucky to have been around that faith and witnessed it and been benefited by it. And it's just, it's very hard that she's gone right now. The poem I'm reading is called Fond Memory. It was a school where all the children wore darned worsted, where they cried, or almost all, when the Reverend Mother announced at lunchtime that the king had died peacefully in his sleep. I dressed in wool as well, ate rationed food, played English games, and learned how wise the Magna Carta was, how hard the Hanoverians had tried. The measure and complexity of verse, the hum and score of the whole orchestra. At 3 o'clock, I caught 2 buses home, where sometimes in the late afternoon, at a piano pushed into a corner of the playroom, My father would sit down and play the slow lilts of Tom Moore, while I stood there trying not to weep at the cigarette smoke stinging up from between his fingers. And as much as I could think, I thought, this is my country, was, will be again. This upward straining song made to be our safe inventory of pain. And I was wrong. The next reader is Shara Leslie.
Can you all hear me? Oh, here we go. A suburban woman, a detail. The chimneys have been swept, the gardens have their winter cut. The shrubs are pinked, the hedges gelded. The last dark shows up the headlights of the cars coming down the Dublin mountains. Our children used to think they were stars. This is not the season when the goddess rose out of seed, out of wheat, out of thawed water and went, distracted and astray, to find her daughter. Winter will be soon, dun pools of rain, ruddy, addled distances, winter pinks, tinges, and a first thing smell of turf when I take the milk in. Setting out her neighbor's house in a denim skirt, a blouse blended in by the last light. I am definite to start with, but the light is lessening, the hedge losing its detail, the path its edge. Look at me, says the tree. I was a woman once like you, full-skirted, human. Suddenly I am not certain of the way I came or the way I will return, only that something which may be nothing, more than darkness has begun, softening the definitions of my body, leaving the fears and all the terrors of the flesh, shifting the airs and forms of the autumn quiet, crying, remember us. The next reader is John Strula.
I'll be reading Inheritance. Inheritance. I have been wondering what I have to leave behind to give my daughters. No good offering the view from here in Three Rock Mountain, the blueness in the hours before rain, the long haze afterwards. The ground I stood on was never really mine. It might not ever be theirs. And gifts that were passed through generations, silver, and the fluid light left after silk, were never given here. This is an island of waters, inland distances, with a history of want, and women who struggled to make the nothing which was all they had into something they could leave behind. I learned so little from them. The lace bobbin with its braided mesh, its oat straw pillow and the wheat-colored shawl, knitted in one season to imitate another, are all crafts I never had and can never hand on. But then again, there was a night I stayed awake, alert and afraid, with my first child, who turned and turned, sick, fretful. When dawn came, I held my hand over the absence of fever, over skin which had stopped burning, as if I knew the secrets of health and air, as if I understood them, and listened to the silence and thought, I must have learned that somewhere. Our next reader is Scott Hutchins.
Thanks, John. I had the pleasure and honor of working with the band for many years. I'm going to read the poem, This Moment. This Moment. A neighborhood at dusk. Things are getting ready to happen out of sight. Stars and moths and rinds slanting around fruit, but not yet. One tree is black, one window is yellow as butter. A woman leans down to catch a child who has run into her arms this moment. Stars rise, moths flutter, apples sweeten in the dark. Our next reader is Samantha Chang.
Thanks. I will be reading Love. Ivan wrote this poem about the 3 months in fall 1979 when she and her husband, novelist Kevin Casey, lived in Iowa City as residents at the University of Iowa International Writing Program. Dark falls on this Midwestern town where we once lived when myths collided. Dusk has hidden the bridge in the river, which slides and deepens to become the water the hero crossed on his way to hell. Not far from here is our old apartment. We had a kitchen and an Amish table. We had a view. And we discovered there love had the feather and muscle of wings and had come to live with us, a brother of fire and air. We had two infant children, one of whom was touched by death in this town and spared. And when the hero was hailed by his comrades in hell, their mouths opened and their voices failed, and there was no knowing what they would have asked about a life they had shared and lost. I am your wife. It was years ago. Our child was healed. We love each other still. Across our day-to-day and ordinary distances, we speak plainly. We hear each other clearly. And yet, I want to return to you on the bridge of the Iowa River as you were, with snow on the shoulders of your coat and a car passing with its headlights on. I see you as a hero in a text, the image blazing and the edges gilded. And I long to cry out the epic question, my dear companion, will we ever live so intensely again? Will love come to us again and be so formidable at rest it offered us ascension even to look at him? But the words are shadows and you cannot hear me. You walk away and I cannot follow. The next reader is Maria Hummel.
I'm going to read from Ivan's poem, The Journey, which was inspired by a lot of the same events as the last poem, her daughter's bout with meningitis. And in it, the poet journeys with Sappho down into the underworld to see the mothers grieving for their lost children. And I'm going to start with the words of Sappho. But these are women who went out like you when dusk became a dark sweet with leaves, recovering the day, stooping, picking up teddy bears and rag dolls and tricycles and buckets, love's archaeology. And they too, like you, stood boot deep in flowers once in summer, or saw winter come in with a single magpie and a call of haws, a solo harlequin. I stood fixed. I could not reach or speak to them. Between us was the melancholy river, the dream water, the narcotic crossing, and they had passed over it, its cold persuasions. I whispered, let me be, let me at least be their witness. But what she said was, what you have seen is beyond speech, beyond song, only not beyond love. Remember it, you will remember it. And I heard her say, but she was fading fast as we emerged under the stars of heaven. There are not many of us. You are dear and stand beside me as my own daughter. I have brought you here so you will know forever the silences in which are our beginnings, in which we have an origin like water. And the wind shifted and the window clasp opened, banged, and I woke up to find the poetry book stacked higgledy-piggledy, my skirt spread out where I had laid it. Nothing was changed, nothing was more clear, but it was wet and the year was late. The rain was grief in arrears. My children slept the last dark out safely, and I wept. And the next reader is Chiyuma Elliott.
I'm reading a really short poem of Evan's called The Old City. This is maybe my favorite poem of hers. The Old City. Small things make the past, make the present seem out of place. A woman cracking and twisting, black atoms falling down on green leaves. If I'm ever to go back to what I loved first, here are words to be wished on. Almost you can see an incantation. Summon blue air out of a corridor between a mountain range and a sea. This, at least, has never changed. Empty out the streets. Fit the cars easily into their parking places. Slow the buses down by 30 years. Observe a brave, fiery shower above a plate of bacon and potatoes. We are nearly there. Now say dinner for lunch and tea time instead of supper. And see how it comes again, my little earth, my city of white pepper. The next reader is Sharif Shanahan.
Talking to my daughter late at night. We have a tray, a pot of tea, a scone. This is the hour when one thing pours itself into another, the gable of our house stored in shadow. A spring planet bending ice into an absolute of light. Your childhood ended years ago. There is no path back to it. There is no certainty I can find, the if or maybe that might remedy an afternoon you walked up the hill after school, in winter, in tears. The fire smolders down into cinders. Lilac shivers in the March dark. If love is a civilization, as I once hoped it was, and you and I are its living citizens, and if our words are less than rules and more than remedies, as we speak, maybe someone escapes from a wounded morning in a small classroom and finds the world is not stern after all. Paper birds are folded and fly off in the playground, and when lessons resume in the afternoon, the essay is easy. It is a day in the life of a penny. Afterwards, at tea time, the sweets have old names. Cinder, toffee, bullseye, marry me quick. The children shout out and I listen to hear your voice with theirs, but no, it's here now, telling me how late the hour is. The birds almost up and we smile at this as we put the tray away, douse the fire and wash out the cups. Bruce Snyder is up next.
An elegy for my mother in which she scarcely appears. I knew we had to grieve for the animals a long time ago, weep for them, pity them. I knew it was our strange human duty to write their elegies after we arranged their demise. I was young then and able for the paradox. I am older now and ready for the question. What happened to them all? I mean to those old dumb implements which have no eyes to plead with us like theirs, no claim to make on us like theirs. I mean, there was a singing kettle. I want to know why no one tagged its neck or ringed the tin base of its extinct design or crouched to hear its rising shriek in winter. Or wrote it down with the birds in their blue sleeves of air, torn away with the trees that sheltered them. And there were brass fire dogs which lay out all evening on the grate and in the heat thrown at them by the last of the peat fire. But no one noted down their history or put them in the old packs under slate blue moonlight. There was a wooden clothes horse, absolutely steady, without sinews, with no mane and no meadows to canter in, carrying, instead of landlords or Irish monks, rinsed tea cloths, but still, I would have thought, worth adding to the catalog of what we need, what we always need, as is my mother, on this Dublin evening of fog crystals and frost, as she reaches out to test one corner of a cloth for dryness, as the pre-war Irish twilight closes in and down on the room, and the curtains are drawn, and here am I, not even born and already a conservationist, with nothing to assist me but the last and most fabulous of beasts, language, language, which knows, as I do, that it's too late to record the loss of these things, but does so anyway, and anxiously, in case it shares their fate. And the next reader is Jay, and Jay, I'll let you say your own name, last name, so I don't massacre it. Is it Deshpande, Jay?
That's exactly it. Thanks, Bruce. Jay Deshpande. The poem I'm going to read, I first found in Ivan's beautiful memoir, Object Lessons, where she describes it. It's about her parents' courtship, and she refers to it as a back-to-front love poem. The black lace fan my mother gave me. It was the first gift he ever gave her, buying it for 5 francs in the galleries in pre-war Paris. It was stifling. A starless drought made the nights stormy. They stayed in the city for the summer. They met in cafes. She was always early. He was late. That evening, he was later. They wrapped the fan. He looked at his watch. She looked down the Boulevard des Capucines. She ordered more coffee. She stood up. The streets were emptying. The heat was killing. She thought the distance smelled of rain and lightning. These are wild roses, appliqued on silk by hand, darkly picked, stitched boldly, quickly. The rest is tortoise shell and has the reticent, clear patience of its element. It is a worn out underwater bullion, and it keeps, even now, an inference of its violation. The lace is overcast as if the weather is opened for an offset had entered it. The past is an empty cafe terrace, an airless dusk before thunder, a man running, and no way to know what happened then, none at all. Unless, of course, you improvise. The blackbird on this first sultry morning in summer, finding buds, worms, fruit, feels the heat. Suddenly, she puts out her wing, the whole, full, flirtatious span of it. The next reader is Jacques Rancourt.
This poem is called Happiness. A Connemara summer, 1940. My father is learning Irish. My mother is painting the harvest. She holds umber and burnt orange up against the canvas. He says Sarah for summer and Aishas for happiness. The Atlantic salts the dark. She packs her colors. It is time to go home to the city where I have yet to be born. They cannot see my sadness as the train moves east through fields, shadows, farms towards my life. They do not hear the wheels saying as I can, never again, never again. Our next reader is Elizabeth Bradfield.
I was first introduced to Ivan's poems by Linda McCarriston, and so I studied her before I met her. And getting to study with Ivan was such a gift. I want to read Lava Cameo. Lava Cameo, a brooch carved on volcanic rock. I like this story. My grandfather was a sea captain. My grandmother always met him when his ship docked. She feared the women at the ports. Except that it is not a story, more a rumor or a folk memory, something thrown out once in random conversation, a hint merely. If I say wool and lace for her skirt and crepe for her blouse, in the neck of which is pinned a cameo carved out of black volcanic rock, if I make her pace the cork docks, stopping to take down her parasol as a gust catches the silk tassels of it, then consider this. There is a way of making free with the past, a pastiche of what is real and what is not, which can only be justified if you think of it as sculpture, as not as sculpture, but as syntax, a structure extrinsic to meaning, which uncovers the inner secret of it. She will die at 31 in a fever ward. He will drown 9 years later in the Bay of Biscay. They will never even be sepia. And so I put down the gangplank now between the ship and the ground. In the story, late afternoon has become evening. They kiss once, their hands touch briefly. Please, look at me. I want to say to her, show me the obduracy of an art which can arrest a profile in the flux of hell. Inscribe catastrophe. The next reader is J.P. Grasser.
Cityscape. I have a word for it. The way the surface waited all day to be a silvery pause between sky and city, which is Elver. And another one for how the bay shelved cirrus clouds piled up at the edge of the Irish Sea, which is Elver, too. The old black rock baths have been neglected now for 50 years, fine cracks in the tiles visible as they never were when I can, shouted Harry Vernon as he dived from the highest board, curving down into salt and urine, his cry fading out through the half century it took to hear as a child that a glass eel had been seen entering the seawater baths at twilight, also known as Elver. And immediately the word begins a delicate migration, a fine, crazing healing in the tiles, the sky deepening above a city that has always been unsettled between sluice gates and the Irish Sea, to which there now comes at dusk a translucent visitor yearning for the estuary. The next reader is Laura Romaine.
The proof that Plato was wrong. August. And already light is assembling another season at the end of an avenue of water. Every tree is getting ready to shed its leaves under. I was young here. I am older here. I have come here to find courage. In the way this dawn reaches slowly down the canal and reveals a drowned summer, which is almost over. In the submarine greenness of these trees, whose roots and sinews are only, after all, rain. And in these birds which cannot be heard, which will never be heard, but are still beginning to raise their heads and open out their flooded wings as if they had not forgotten what song is. The next reader is Alexandra Teague.
This is The Harbor from The Lost Land, which was the first book of Evans that I really knew and loved. And the end of this poem speaks to what I think one of the things that Evan could so wonderfully do. The harbor. This harbor was made by art and force and called Kingstown and afterwards Dunlera, and holds the sea behind its barrier less than 5 miles from my house. Lord be with us, say the makers of a nation. Lord look down, say the builders of a harbor. They came and cut a shape out of ocean and left stone to close around their labor. Officers and their wives promenaded on this spot once and saw with their own eyes the opulent horizon and obedient skies, which 9/10 of the law provided. And frigates with 36 guns cruising the outer edges of influence could idle and enter here and catch the tide of empire and arrogance and the Irish Sea rising and rising through a century of storms and cormorants and moonlight the whole length of this coast, while an ocean forgot an empire and the armed ships under it changed to slime weed and cold salt and rust. City of shadows and of the gradual capitulations to the last invader. This is the final one, signed in water and witnessed in granite and ugly bronze and gunmetal. And by me, I am your citizen, composed of your fictions, your compromise. I am a part of your story and its outcome, and ready to record its contradictions. The next reader is Will Brewer.
I'm gonna read Atlantis, a lost sonnet. How on earth did it happen? I used to wonder that a whole city, arches, pillars, colonnades, not to mention vehicles and animals, had all one fine day gone under. I mean, I said to myself, the world was small then. Surely a great city must have been missed. I miss our old city, white pepper, white pudding, you and I meeting under fan lights and low skies to go home in it. Maybe what really happened is this. The old fable makers searched hard for a word to convey that what is gone forever, and never found it. And so, in the best traditions of where we come from, they gave their sorrow a name and drowned it. The next reader is Brittany Perrin.
This is Once. The lovers in an Irish story never had good fortune. They fled the king's anger. They lay on the forest floor. They kissed at the edge of death. Did you know our suburb was a forest? Our roof was a home for thrushes. Our front door was a wild shadow of spruce. Our faces edged in mountain freshness. We took our milk where the wide apart prints of the wild and never seen creatures were set who have long since died out. I do not want us to be immortal or unlucky, to listen for our own death in the distance. Take my hand, stand by the window. I want to show you what is hidden in this ordinary aging human love is still there and will be, until an inland coast so densely wooded, not even the ocean fog could enter it, appears in front of us, and the chill to the bone light clears and shows us Irish wolves, a silvery man and wife, yellow-eyed, edged in dateless moonlight. They are mated for life. They are legendary. They are safe. Thank you, Ivan. The next reader is Mario Char.
Such a tremendous honor to read here. I love this poem for how it displays mastery of the rhetorical, like Ivan did, but how it is also an indictment of rhetoric. That the science of cartography is limited. And not simply by the fact that this shading of forest cannot show the fragrance of balsam, the gloom of cypresses, is what I wish to prove. When you and I were first in love, we drove to the borders of Cannock and entered a wood there. Look down, you said. This was once a famine road. I looked down at ivy and the scutch grass, rough cast stone had disappeared into, as you told me, in the second winter of their ordeal in 1847, when the crop had failed twice, relief committees gave the starving Irish such roads to build. Where they died, there the road ended and ends still. And when I take down the map of this island, it is never so I can say, here is the masterful, the apt rendering of the spherical as flat, nor an ingenious design which persuades a curve into a plane, but to tell myself again that the line which says woodland and cries hunger and gives out among sweet pine and cypress and finds no horizon will not be there. Thank you, Ivan. This reader is Keith Ekus.
Thank you, Mario. This is Unheroic from Ivan's sequence, Colony in the Lost Land. It was an Irish summer. It was wet. It was a job. I was 17. I set the clock and caught the bus at 8 and leaned my head against the misty window. The city passed by. I got off above the Liffey on a street of statues, iron orators and granite patriots, arms wide, lips apart, last words. I worked in a hotel. I carried trays. I carried keys. I saw the rooms when they were used and airless, and again when they were aired and ready. And I stood above the road and stared down at silent eloquence and wet umbrellas. There was a man who lived in the hotel. He was a manager. I rarely saw him. There was a rumor that he had a wound from war or illness, no one seemed sure, which would not heal. And when he finished his day of ledgers and telephones, he went up the back stairs to his room to dress it. I never found out where it was. Someone said in his thigh, someone else said deep in his side. He was a quiet man. He spoke softly. I saw him once or twice on the stairs at the back of the building by the laundry. Once I waited, curious to see him. Mostly I went home. I got my coat and walked bareheaded to the river, past the wet, bronze and unbroken skin of those who learned their time and knew their country. How do I know my country? Let me tell you, it has been hard to do. And when I do go back to difficult knowledge, it is not to that street or those men raised high above the certainties they stood on, Ireland, hero, history, but how I went behind the linen room and up the stone stairs and climbed to the top and stood for a moment there, concealed by shadows, in a hiding place, waiting to see, wanting to look again into the patient face of the unhealed. Our next reader is Kirsten Valdez Quaid.
This poem is called, I went to find the grave of my grandmother, who died before my time and hers. I searched among marsh grass and granite and single headstones and smashed lettering and archangel wings and found none. For once I said, I will face this landscape and look at it as she was looked upon, unloved because unknown, unknown because unnamed. Glass Pistol Castle disappeared, Beltray and then Clowerhead. To the west, the estuary of the Boyne, stripped of its battles and history, became only willow trees and distances. I drove back in the half-light of late summer on anonymous roads on my journey home, as the constellations rose overhead, some of them twisted into women, pinioned and winged and single-handedly holding high the dome and curve and horizon of today and tomorrow. All the ships looking up to them, all the compasses made true by them, all the night skies named for their sorrow. The next reader is Brian Spears.
Before I read Envoy, I'd just like to thank you, Kimmy, and everybody else who has had a part in putting this together. It's something I probably wouldn't have been able to be a part of otherwise, and Evan meant an awful lot to me in those years that I was at Stanford, and I'm just glad to be able to be a part of this with all of you. Envoy. It is Easter in the suburb. Clematis shrubs the eaves and trellises with pastel. The evenings lengthen, and before the rain, the Dublin mountains become visible. My muse must be better than those of men who made theirs in the image of their myth. The work is half finished, and I have nothing but the crudest measures to complete it with. Under the street lamps, the dustbins brighten. The winter flowering jasmine casts a shadow outside my window in my neighbor's garden. These are the things that my muse must know. She must come to me. Let her come to be among the donné, the given. I need her to remain with me until the day is over and the song is proven. Surely she comes. Surely she comes to me, no lizard skin, no paps, no potted womb about her, but a brightening and the consequences of an April tomb. What I have done alone. What I have seen is unverified. I have the truth and I need the faith. It is time I put my hand in her side. If she will not bless the ordinary, if she will not sanctify the common, then here I am and here I stay, and then am I the most miserable of women. Our next reader is Hugh Martin.
Hi, everyone. This is the Emigrant Irish. Like oil lamps, we put them out back of our houses, of our minds. We had lights better then, newer then, and then a time came. This time and now, we need them. Their dread, makeshift example. They would have thrived on our necessities. What they survived, we could not even live. By their lights now, it is time to imagine how they stood there, what they stood with, that their possessions may become our power. Cardboard, iron, their hardships parceled in them. Patience, fortitude, long suffering in the bruise-colored dusk of the new world. And all the old songs and nothing to lose. The next reader is Peter Klein.
This poem is called, Is It Still the Same? Is it still the same young woman who climbs the stairs, who closes a child's door, who goes to her table in a room at the back of the house? The same unlighted corridor, the same night air over the wheelbarrows and rain tanks, the same inky sky and pin bright stars. You can see nothing of her, but her head bent over the page, her hand moving, moving again, and her hair. I wrote like that once, but this is different. This time, when she looks up, I will be there. Our next reader is Jim Whiteside.
Hi, everyone. I will be reading a poem from Van's book, The Lost Land, which is the book that introduced me to her work back when I was an undergraduate. And this poem is called A Habitable Grief. Long ago, I was a child in a strange country. I was Irish in England. I learned a second language there, which has stood me in good stead, the lingua franca of a lost land, a dialect in which what had never been could still be found, that infinite horizon, always far and impossible, that contrary passion to be whole. This is what language is, a habitable grief, a turn of speech for the everyday and ordinary abrasion of losses such as this, which hurts just enough to be a scar and heals just enough to be a nation. Our next reader is Caroline Goodwin.
Thank you. I'm so grateful to be here with you all to honor Evan. Like so many of us, I will never forget her voice on my answering machine inviting me to Stanford in 1999. I was working at a nonprofit in Sitka, Alaska, and I couldn't believe my ears. It seems like just yesterday. I know that voice that changed my life will always be a part of me and of my work. I'll read The Blossom. A May morning, light starting in the sky. I have come here after a long night, its senses of loss, its unrelenting memories of happiness. The blossom on the apple tree is still in shadow, its petals half white and filled with water at the core, in which the freshness and secrecy of dawn are stored even in the dark. How much longer will I see girlhood in my daughter? In other seasons, I knew every leaf on this tree. Now I stand here, almost without seeing them, and so lost in grief, I hardly notice what is happening. As the light increases and the blossom speaks and turns to me with blonde hair, my eyebrows, and says, imagine if I stayed here, even for the sake of your love. What would happen to the summer, to the fruit? Then holds out a dawn-soaked hand to me, whose fingers I counted at birth years ago, and touches mine for the last time and falls to earth. The next reader is Michael Shoemaker.
Endings. A child shifts in a cot. No matter what happens now, I'll never feel one again. It's a night white things ember in. Jasmine and the shine, flowering opaline of the apple trees. If I lean, I can see what it is the branches end in. The leaf, the reach, the blossom, the abandon. Our last reader is Esther Lynn.
Hi, I'll be reading from Anna Liffey. In the end, it will not matter that I was a woman. I am sure of it. The body is a source, nothing more. There is a time for it. There is a certainty, about the way it seeks its own dissolution. Consider rivers. They are always en route to their own nothingness. From the first moment, they are going home. And so, when language cannot do it for us, cannot make us know love will not diminish us, there are these phrases of the ocean to console us, particular and unafraid of their completion. In the end, everything that burdened and distinguished me will be lost in this. I was a voice. Thank you, Ivan.
So I'm Natali Jabbar, and this concludes tonight's tribute. We wanted to thank everybody for gathering here this evening, for reading, and for listening as we remember and celebrate Ivan's life. Ivan had a surprising love of technology and probably would have been delighted and bemused by hundreds of us coming together in this strange format across time zones and continents. We've recorded tonight's event and plan to make it publicly available sometime in the future, so please look out for that. In the meantime, thank you everybody again, and take care.
Good night.